Hello and welcome to the SWN Podcast. I am your host, as always, Billy. And yes, your eyes don't deceive you. I do actually have professional equipment now. Look at it. It's scary. It's terrifying. But I am joined on this edition. This is the first recording in 2022. It is a returning guest. It is the Crimson Cobra. It's the rise of Crimson Cobra himself. It's Craig Berry. Welcome back.
Hi there. I'm not okay with it being 2022. I'm still processing 2020, if I'm honest.
I know. So I was looking at it just before we hit record. I was getting confused when we last spoke. I'm going to guess it went out August 2020, and I can't believe it was that long ago that it went out. So it'll probably be a 4 weeks I had between recording it and putting it out there. Yeah, it's not right. It's weird.
Yes, it's awful.
But a lot has happened in that year and a bit, which we'll get into during the show. Like I was saying again, for anyone that's listened to this, this is the second episode of season four. I've still no idea what I'm doing. I've now got all the gear and now no idea. So it's improved somewhat. It's 50% more professional.
Yeah, you look professional anyway. That's the main part, you know?
That's the important thing. As long as I look the part, that's we've got a ring light. Since I was actually watching the video that I watched it. I thought, no, I'll listen to it because that seems way better. I don't want to look at my face. And it was just this background, but nothing. It was just me and this microphone just going, like, question, nothing in the background. I could have been anywhere. I could have been a casting couch behind me for all anyone knew. It was such a weird dystopian room.
Hang on, you haven't told me it was that kind of interview. Hang on a minute.
Well, they're all explicit now. I forgot to say, you are a returning guest. You don't have to worry about swearing. You can swear as much as you want. So that's the rules. If you come back a second time, nothing's off limits. Of course, we don't like slander. We can avoid that if we can. No fire alarms being pulled at this particular juncture.
Here we go. That was my plan all along, you know.
Skip out just before the last question, before we ask about Comic-Con. anyway, so let's just get into it then. So it's been a year and a bit since we last spoke. You finally had your debut, Matt. Let's go right into the big one, which is major debut. So May 2020 was when FPWA showcase was supposed to be. Yes. Of course, it got cancelled, and it finally happened December 2021. When did you find out that it was finally actually happening and you were going to be able to wrestle in front of a crowd?
About a month before it happened. Andy and Hannah and that, they kind of sprung it on us. I just remember being at a training session, and Andy just says, oh yeah, by the way, guys, about a month from the day, we're going to be doing our first student showcase. To immediately, everyone's reaction was like, what? What's going on? Which was a bit daunting at first, because like I did not think that 2021 I would get to wrestle. Like I'd said, obviously, at the start of the year, being like, oh, this is the year I'm going to make my debut. This is the year that I'm going to, like, you know, make my mark in that. And sure enough, I didn't get to make a mark, but I did get to make a debut, which, you know, with a month to go, I just thought, nah, it's not happening. I'll just keep training. And then for that to come out of the blue, and I only thought I was going to get one match. But unfortunately, you know, people had to pull out, and I offered to step in for another match. So I technically got two, which was great. But the first match, that was nerve-wracking. I'm not going to lie.
Oh, that was Johnny Reeves and Devin Antrim against yourself and Zach Swift. I've got them all inside FPWA. I've got the results.
So, I saw that and I was thinking, who leaked that? I wasn't that stricken from the record that I lost that night. So,
you've had a couple. I've seen, like, obviously progress through Instagram and what have you. You have had a couple run-ins with Johnny Reeves in training, and had a couple training matches with him. So was that a bit easier to get in? You knew you trained with these guys, you've had a little bit of a go at the wrestling with them already.
Yeah.
So was that, you're nervous, but did that kind of ease it a little bit?
Yeah, like I was very comfortable in the ring with them. It was more of a case of just thinking, right, okay, this is what you've been training for. Don't mess it up. Don't, you know, just don't do that. I was like trying to not get inside my own head with it, which is funny because usually I can be quite a confident person. But when it came to that, I'm just thinking, let's not show my arse here kind of thing. As you said, I've had a few run-ins with Johnny Reeves and that before. We know each other very well, but unfortunately, I actually never didn't get to get in the ring with him very much that match. I had to wrestle Devin, who I've not had a lot of time in the ring with. So as you're saying, like, yes, I've trained with those guys and we've got some, we're very comfortable with each other. I'm not as comfortable with Devin at that point. But it went well. I know we were someone's favourite match of the night because they commented on FPW's Facebook, so we did something right. And yeah, it was just very good.
I'll tell you, of course, unfortunately, that was not a win for your debut.
No.
But when I was looking at the results for that show, seeing the likes of course, names that I'll know, like Caleb and what have you, but seeing Johnny Lyons wrestle was quite a shock. Seeing his name on there, I think he's retired, but there's bloody Johnny Lyons. He's back there.
Oh, you know, he's still retired. It's it was, you know, because obviously, you know, on the first night, Lewis Young, who we all love Lewis. He issued a challenge and Johnny had to accept it. It's, you know, it had to happen. And if anyone was gonna get Johnny out of retirement, it had to be Lewis. So, you know.
I'm all in for more Johnny. Even if he said he's done, yeah, I've got enough of Johnny Lyons just yet. Anyway, night two, which was the 2 days later. Another tag team match. It was Redfield and yourself against Maverick and Brent Carter. Of course, Brent is a popular person on this show. He seems to be popping up every time there's an episode. He's there, which he's got many questions, which we'll get onto. So after you got one match out of the way, this one must have been a little bit less nerve wracking. And you'd be like, oh, it's fine. I've got my first. I've got the worst one out of the way. This will just be easy. Comparison.
Oh yeah, because by the end of the first match, after I realised that wasn't my fault that we lost the match, it was Zach's fault, you know, because obviously he took the pinfall, of course. I just kind of figured, like, yeah, okay, this will be good. Let's go in here. Swap tag partners, got Redfield in there. You know his thing, like he loves everybody and stuff. if we're going kayfabe with it. It was still okay. I think after I got over the jitters, I think that was a much better match. Not to take away from the first match I did have, because obviously I think I did well in that match too. But I think obviously because I wasn't feeling as nervous, I wasn't getting inside my own head as much. It was more of a case of no, this is actually I'm feeling more comfortable, more confident. there was a lot of kids in the audience that night who just had it out for me and Redfield. And for whatever reason, you know, just I was crazy, I was ugly, I was everything under the sun. I was like, oh, okay, thanks guys, you know, cheers. But yeah, it was a still good match. Brent and Maverick were great opponents, just not good enough to beat us that night.
But I quite liked it when it was Redfield and yourself, because of course Crimson Cobra, Redfield, you know, there's like a rouge gallery going on that you've formed. You can keep that one.
Yeah.
We'll
see.
I know. Again, we're also to the previous episode. I thought this wasn't that bad, and then the Betty nickname started towards the end. I thought, oh, I could see why I should have stopped speaking really quickly, because it was just. I thought it was funny at the time, clearly, because I was laughing to myself, and then I listened back to it going, no. Let's not retread Craig Strawberry. Let's not do any of that. I don't want to give those kids ideas.
No, let's not. It's a good thing kids don't listen to your podcast, right?
Exactly. Just throw in a bunch of swear words now, just like, fuck. You know, it's just so kids definitely can't listen to it.
It's 18 plus, you can't do it.
Exactly. Just as bad. But oh, it was quite good hearing, back then, just you hadn't started. We talked about, of course, your knee injury and everything around about that. But now that you're actually in the ring, how was that a worry again, back to the knee? Was that a thought, if anything could go wrong, it would be that? Or
I didn't think about it too much because, in all honesty, it actually hasn't been bothering me as much. I thought, like, you're during the winter and that, it does, obviously, because I've got, like, less cartilage in my knee now. It just stiffens up every now and again. But, like, so far, it's been great. It's not actually held me back or anything. I've been able to do a lot more than I thought I could be able to do. Not saying anything, like, you know, I can't, I'm not a high flyer or anything by any means, but, like, I can still move, which is great. On the nights, I did think, yeah, if anything was going to go wrong, I'm going to pop my knee out of its socket again, and, like, you know, I'll break it, and my leg's going to turn all the way around, and it'll be going to be a horror show, you know. Like, yeah, those thoughts did come, but eventually, as soon as, like, as cliche as it sounds, as soon as my music hit, I just switched off, and Crimson Cobra came out, and that was that. You know, like, all those worries didn't go away. It was a case of, no, I don't care. In the weirdest sense, I don't care about Craig Berry's knee because Crimson Cobra is wanting to hurt people. If you catch the drift, yeah.
Okay, so yeah, as soon as the music hits, that's it. Craig Berry, the person outside of FPWA, he's gone. That's it. It's all over.
Non-existent.
Yeah. Excellent. That's quite a good quick mindset to get into. Because I don't know, I've done it myself, but I like to. You like to think that maybe it takes a couple of goes before you properly switch, but it's a very common answer that is, as soon as that music hits, that's it, you're the wrestler, that's who you are. Yeah. Which is, it's all good. Like I say, the crowd clearly reacted. First night, someone loved it, and second night, everyone hated you. So, you know, it's just, you get the balance.
I mean, I did my job. It's fine.
It's all you can hope for at the end of the day, especially, like, everyone's come out of it unscathed, relatively, and you've done the job you need to do.
I mean, I'm pretty sure I hurt Brent a little bit, but that's fine.
Maybe that's why he's throwing in so many questions. But
probably, like, by the way, probably.
Like I said, I'm just teasing folk. We'll get to them eventually, I'm sure. So the other things, I mean, rewind back then. So August 2020, our episode went out. It was episode number. Oh, I've went into the deep end there because I didn't write that down. But it was an early one. It was an early season one episode of the show. Must be like 10 or something like that. And since then. Must be, because it started in end of June 2020. So very early on, I was again listening back to it. I interrupted you loads, which I just did there as well, which is so I haven't learned anything in this time.
I didn't really worry.
But since then, of course, then it's kind of been a bit mixed when it comes to being able to train, because of course we started it, we're still in the midst of a lockdown, pandemic, it got worse, then it got better, then it got worse, and then Christmas was cancelled, and then we were back into the swing of things a little bit. But you kept yourself busy. I was noticing FPWA were just putting out loads of stuff, webinars, seminars, everything that you can think of with R at the end. Was that the way keeping you focused on the wrestling, or how did you find yourself being able to try and keep yourself involved in FPWA during that time?
So again, like, all the way throughout the pandemic and continuing so, because we're not quite out of the woods yet, FPWA has, you know, provided as much as they can, and, you know, they physically have been possible to, with the seminars, with doing other things as well. You know, both Andy, Hannah, and Stu as well have, like, went above and beyond everything. The seminars were okay. While the seminars weren't probably my favorite thing to be doing, because obviously, like, a Zoom call every week is a bit like, oh, okay. But it was still really good. Like, I learned so much from so many different you know, people with, like, world class talents around the world. To name a few, NWA, well, I need to catch up with NWA again, but, you know, multiple-time NWA world champion Nick Aldis. That was one that actually shocked me when I first saw him. Well, you know, even just getting to talk to him for, like, a little bit and ask him questions, learn from him, was great. I'm very much interested in doing more tag team stuff. So when we got to get a seminar with the, you know, the Kings of the North, again, brilliant. And that opened up, like, you know, obviously, there's, like, you know, you can speak to, you know, pretty much anybody you want, but, like, even just, like, talking to them that way, and then afterwards going to, like, you know, social media and, like, messaging them and getting them to review stuff has been an absolute, you know, helped me so much. other than this, the webinars, the seminars that we've had, there's been other things that we've been doing. So we did like a promo tournament during the second lockdown, technically. Second one was a bit more complex, so because instead of just, you know, the whole, oh, do a promo and send it in, we'll review it and that, we actually got to set challenges. So first one, for example, do a 30-second promo, but don't speak during it and get your character across. Harder than it looks. You know, you don't speak to camera with that. You know, second one, okay, do what you did the first time, but now you can speak. And then the third one, we got partnered with someone and got told, right, okay, do like a promo, like off each other. So like, you know, do a promo calling somebody out, and then the other one's like, you know, coming back and accepting the challenge. Just like all the stuff I had to learn, and it was really good. And then obviously by that point, as soon as we got like the last webinar out, we got back to training, although non-contact, it was still really good. Helped with the cardio, and yeah, just amazing. Like, I can't sing FBWA's praises enough, and I'm pretty sure anyone that's ever trained with FBWA or, you know, continues to train with FBWA can say the same.
Yeah, and again, I was looking at, pretty much I stopped your Twitter this morning while I was just writing up a bits and pieces about what to speak about tonight. And yeah, when you're saying the FPWA brought in these big names, you're not wrong. It's like, you know, like say Nick Aldis being NWA champion, he's a guy who's went from the UK, he went from Gladiators, and then to NWA champion. That's just mind-blowing, and he went to TNA in between. And then Mark Andrews, of course, NXT UK, Kings of the North, mm-hmm. who no doubt that already they're making their way around the UK as well as at home in Ireland as well. So Northern Ireland, I should say, there's mm-hmm. clarification. But yeah, so they're clearly doing all the things that's right to make a name across and get booked places. You speak about the promo tournament as well. I think I spoke to, it was Harmony Sky. I think she won the first one. Am I right in thinking that?
She won the first one, yeah.
With a promo against Jason Reed, I think it was. So it's a really great way, because to be honest, that's probably the most important bit about wrestling, in my opinion, anyway. I mean, the wrestling, of course, is very important because, you know, the actual show itself. But if you can't talk people into the seats, then nobody's going to come see you wrestle. So as long as you can do that. Of course, Billy Kirkwood was another one I spotted when I was scrolling down, who's, you know, big character guy. If he can find something to put you over in commentary, then that's you sorted, that's you sold for a little bit as well. Was there anyone in particular, like say, Nick Aldis kind of surprised you when you saw the name pop up? Was there anyone that when you're listening to them go, I've taken a lot more than I thought I would out of this? Anyone in particular?
So we got obviously, you know that Andy's debuted for NXT UK and that so far, and you know, hopefully we're going to see him back on there again. Again, I'm not too sure when, but you know, we did manage to get a seminar with WWE referee Chris Sharp, who like gave us a lot of like information, and you know, taught us a lot from that kind of side of the business as well, you know, that like third corner in the ring almost, from his point of view, and like what they get fed through and what wrestlers should be doing, because obviously they're helping direct traffic as well. So like when I first heard that we were going to get, I was like, oh, it's okay, that's cool. But I didn't go into it expecting the takeaway as much as I did. And just thinking, okay, no, that's like, it really just opened my eyes.
Yeah, you find that there's a lot more to it than you actually think when it comes to being a referee or anything like that. You're just like, oh, they've actually got a really hard job, and they have to be invisible at the same time.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. Yeah, it's like I knew that their job was really important, but I didn't just realize like how important, I don't think, at the time, which is kind of shocking to say the least. But at the same time, it's like, okay, no, so I've got a newfound appreciation, and yeah.
Did you find once Andy had made his NXT UK debut, which I don't know if you would have, I'm assuming the class would be cancelled a week, you're wondering why, but was there, when you saw him on NXT or when it was announced, was there a two half of like Celebration. Yay, that's him on NXT UK. Or, oh, our training's going to get a lot harder because he's going to take all these tips and everything while he's down there and bring them right back up, and he's going to drill us with them.
So fun fact as well, during the time that Andy did, like what was down there, you know, to record his matches and everything like that, he didn't actually cancel training, he didn't cancel the classes or that. So when it was, I think it was, he would still do the webinars and seminars and everything, and we're just thinking, like, that doesn't look like, you know, your usual spot that you're in. Well, what's going on there? You know, trying to hide it and everything like that. Because he did hide it from us at first. But yeah, we were celebrating for him. We were very happy for him. And then it was like the realization of like the first training session back. We're thinking, oh no. Yeah. Because like training's already hard. Like it's not easy. But then again, nothing is easy if you do want to like make it and stuff. And that's what Andy is trying to do. He's trying to get us ready for like, he's trying to give us like a head start, I'd say, by taking stuff from NXT UK and drilling it into us, essentially. So we're working on like, okay, working for like TV matches and everything like that, because that's what they want you to do and everything like that there. And yeah, we're getting like new drills and new exercises, which I never knew you could do this sort of stuff for your body and stuff. I'm like, okay, this really hurts, but yeah, it's good.
Thing with me, say like Andy's now got the little he's got the insight on what they're looking for, and you can bring it back and then tell you if you're wanting to go this direction, this is what they're looking for, kind of thing as well, yeah. which is always handy. You get the likes of course Andy and Iron Girders as well, because Wolfgang's there and Joe Henry's school. So there's a lot of places now that have got these coaches that have got these experiences of. Right, this is what you need to make it to NXT UK or make it to Ring of Honor or to get noticed. And it's quite exciting to see, because even, well, a year ago, of course, pandemic notwithstanding, there was like little glimpses of places that would have the tools to provide that. GPWA, of course, would have had some of it as well. And then now we've got so many coaches in Scotland alone that have got all these little nuggets of information to get you to, like I say, if you want to go to NXT UK, if you want to go abroad, Scandinavia or anything, there's always someone who's got contact now in Scotland, yeah. Which we're quite for a small country, we're quite a hub of knowledge now and contact to get anywhere you want to get, which is nice. It's nice to see. Detouring somewhat from the wrestling, so we'll get back to like summer camps and what have you, just because it's come to mind. You were the first one that became the dinosaur question, that stuck as a dinosaur question. It was obviously asked in previous episodes. I was noticing a tweet that you sent us when I put out my 100 favourite dinosaurs.
Oh, yeah.
About Barney.
Yes.
So he was number 97 on my list because I hate Barney. But...
I understand that now.
how was my placement of BJ, though? Are you quite agreement with BJ? I think he was 100. I think he was the worst.
Yeah, no, that's fair. But no, Barney needs to be higher. If the fact he was not in your top 10, I don't expect him to be number one, but the fact you had Charizard in there, and he's like, he's not a dinosaur, he's not even a dragon. That's the thing. You know,
close enough. Internet Explorer in that list. You can't, that kind of killed the credibility of it when I had Internet Explorer as a dinosaur, because it is an awful piece of software. I realized I could have put more like established dinosaurs near the end when I was putting really tedious things. Well, I think I'd top 10 was Walk Like a Dinosaur, it was the song.
I remember like a lot of people being quite annoyed by that list on what, no, because their dinosaur wasn't higher or something like that.
That's what I loved about it. It was just getting almost irrationally angry about it. And I was looking at it going, it's a terrible list. I know it is, so just get it out there. It's always the case after I finished it, I thought of another dinosaur and I was like, ah, shit. Oh, someone's getting bumped. So Barney. Barney's only got three more dinosaurs for me to think of before he's out of that list entirely.
That's fair enough.
Anyway, well, that was a quick detour there while I had my notes in front of me. The Summer Camp, FPWA. So they put on a, was it a 2 week camp? It was quite a lengthy.
It was only 2 days.
Two days.
So like two full days, and yeah, it was great. Like learned so much from it and got to actually work with other people as well. So Sam Barber, for example, he was in my group. Ashley Vega as well. It was good. Awesome.
It was a bit more of an intensive. Was it? Oh, it was 2 days, but it was quite a big chunk of time. Am I right? I think that was like a work day kind of thing.
Yeah, essentially, like, it was like two full days. Two full days kind of thing. Lot of like drills, exercise, and like, you know, going over fundamentals on the first day, second day, again fundamentals, and then like putting like a match together kind of thing. You know, pairing up with somebody, putting a match together, get reviewed, everything like that. And like, it was a learning experience, and especially in the work with so many different people too. For everything, and just take on board back the feedback. Like, yeah.
So how are you finding seeing likes of FPWA guys appearing on, and girls, appearing on things like WWE Network and all that? Was that, again, another thing reaffirming that you're making the right choices in the right direction? Andy's the guy for this. Can you keep you on the straight and narrow towards it? When you're seeing like Harmony Sky, Talon Jr., of course, Bomar, Omar Mohammed appearing on the WWE Network. Was that kind of bit mad to see?
That was both mad, inspiring, and also filled me with jealousy at the same time. Just going, no, but I'm very happy for everyone at FPWA that has appeared on the network, and it just makes me want it more, especially because I get to train now with not only a coach that has appeared all over and is on has appeared on NXT UK, but I get to train with people like me. Okay, maybe not 100% like me, but like almost the same level as me that have appeared on the network as well. And I'm thinking, right, okay, if they can do it, I can do it. And yeah, and maybe they've got a different opinion. Maybe they're thinking, no, they can't. But that's, you know, because there's always going to be people out there that say you can't, so I can prove them wrong.
Yeah, absolutely. But yeah, so like I say, seeing all those names appear on there, it's yeah, like it's a good inspiration. It's a good tool for you to move on. Same with the likes of Discovery Wrestling. They had the recently, of course, the FPWA versus Joe Henry School, a little 6-man tag. Is that another match that when you saw it announced and seen who was picked, thinking next time? That's me. I can be in there.
Oh yeah, definitely. Again, happy for them as well. I'm quite good friends with Beth Shorty. So like, when it was announced, obviously big congratulations to her. Even bigger congratulations when they won. And it was a case of, right, okay, yeah, no, like next show that's gonna be me. Or like it's just a case of like I've always wanted to go for Discovery as well, and like even just getting a spot on like, you know, the Disco Derby, or just like even like a pre-show match like they got would mean loads. But it just means I'm gonna have to work harder for it.
Do you find that after you made your debut, that was when the hunger became like more? It's like, all right, I've got one, now I've got two. I want more. I want everywhere. I want to be pro too. I want to be everywhere that can have me. Did you find that was? Were you surprised about that, how that hunger grew, or were you knew it was going to happen as soon as you got your first match in?
Yeah. Well, originally it was meant to be 3 matches. I was meant to have. Only because some might say teacher's prep. I just say like you're saying hungry at this point. It was a case of, because obviously the beginners class were meant to have their showcase on the Monday, but that had to get pulled because there was a lot of basically you know, concerns for COVID, and then a few people had to, you know, pull out because of either COVID or because they couldn't make it on the days. So some of the matches got cancelled and got moved to like other days. So for example, like Lewis's match was meant to be on the Monday, but then it got moved to the Tuesday. And just stuff like that happens. But yeah, after like the first and the second match, it did leave me like hungry, saying, where's that third match commit now? Like, come on, when's the next one? Like, just left me like trying to put like stuff together for like a CB match footage. And I've only had like, you know, those two debut like pro matches in front of a crowd. So it doesn't leave you a lot of stuff like you need to put into it and stuff and anything like that. But it does leave me wanting more. I do want to go out there more. I do want to try and make make an impact, leave a mark in 2022. I do want to work for as many promotions as I can. And that is like one of my goals, is just to actually debut for another promotion other than FPWA. So like, you know, if you've got any contacts, you've got any like sway, you can just pass my name along and that'd be great. And or, you know.
I would have any sway at all. That would be wonderful. But yeah, so there's plenty of coming. Of course, as well, this is a very big advert for FPWA, but they've earned it. They've clearly got a lot of guys coming through it that are surely making a wave and making an impact, like you're saying. But you've got guys like, of course, you've got Caleb, who's originally at WrestleZone. You've got Omar, who's appearing in Fair City and places. Of course, you've got Johnny, who probably knows more people in wrestling than most, and Andy, of course, as well. So it's a good network of a good networking place that's FPWA is. And of course, Andy is touring around the country. I mean, I said Pro 2 as a little bit of an offhanded joke, but he is going to be Pro 2. And that place is full of places that I've got, like Bobby Roberts, I've got Luke King Sharp, I've got Frank Cross, all these places that are. There are opportunities for everywhere. So like we were saying, Scotland is this place where it's got all these contacts and all these places that can get you to where you need to be. There's so many companies now that if you get into one place, all it takes is someone to go, oh, what about this guy? And then you're in another place. And then it's a small world, but at the same time, it's quite vast. Do it that way, I suppose. Anyway, right, we're going to detour back out of the wrestling because we're going to get some of these Brent Carter questions in. We'll leave the Paul McCall one for the end because it sounds like it has to be the last question or near the end anyway. So the first
one. That'll keep Brent listening at least till the end. So
exactly. Got to just reel him in a little bit, reel him in.
Yeah.
So the first one I've got here is best sleepover you've ever had.
I know what he's referring to as well. I believe he's referring to the time where, obviously for the summer camps, me and him were in like the same kind of group. So he had asked politely if, like, you know, and saves him traveling all the way from Perth at stupid o'clock in the morning, just to come and stay at mine's. And I said, yeah, sure, that's fine. We'll get some food. We'll put on some, like, you know, old school TNA or whatever you want to watch, and we'll cuddle up, and it'll be great. And yeah, it was I know that's what he's referring to. And it, like, there's no much more to say apart from that, and apart from annoying his girlfriend when she was on Twitch. So just with horrible fish puns.
Oh, you know? I do like a fish pun.
I can't even think of a fish pun to say there, but you know.
I know, I reeled you in with that, and then I couldn't think of any. Ah, here we go.
There you go.
There we are. But yeah, so yeah, Brent is, when I was again scrolling through for my research today, the picture of him winning the Day of Birth Bonanza with his trophy, or his belt, I had blocked that image out of my head. And then I scrolled and found it again. I was like,
oh no.
Oh, I forgot that was a thing. So
that's like the one belt I don't want to win now. Like, you know, he can have that for life.
Well, I
no offense, but
I think the plan really was to get him back on next or for next birthday one and do it again. But then my wife saw it. I saw the picture and went, that belt's not coming back into my house. That's not coming back into the house. Well, I think he might be the champion forever then, because
he's a one-time champion. That's
if he wants to defend it, he is more than welcome to. He could take it in next showcase and defend it. But Dettol, maybe give it a couple wipes and
Yeah, just picking up with like, you know, a pair of tongs going, ah, okay, like, there we go.
ladder match, you know, just trying to avoid touching it. He's also asked, do you own any nice hats?
I know what he's referring to with that. I actually own a very nice hat that my auntie knitted for me. I'm not going to grab it though because it involves getting up and I'm currently still sore from last night's training session. But I do know what he's on about. So he's been in America the past couple of days. Actually, the past couple of days, he was there for Christmas. And he has been so kind enough to essentially abide by two people's requests to get them anime merch, me being one of these people. And I seen this lovely hat when he FaceTimed me when he was in Hot Topic, and there's an Attack on Titan hat, and I said, oh, that looks nice, if you get me that, I'll give you the money for it. So I guess he's referring to that. I think he's just trying to put himself over as like a really nice guy at this point.
I'm starting to think that as well. Yeah,
like, you know, I'm just like, you bastard kind of thing. But like, he's just, yeah, no, he's going to be my friend as well. He's trying to make me look bad.
I'm going to guess the third question is that as well. What was the best haircut you've ever been given?
So before the the summer camps, after the first day, like, my hair was a bit like this, kind of a mess. And I said, right, okay, I'm going to need to go for a haircut. But the hairdressers weren't open. But luckily, Brian had actually brought his clippers with him because he just does it himself. And I said, yeah, you could just, like, you know, shave the sides after me or whatever. And he did, and yes, it by far was the best haircut I've ever had. There you go, Brent. It's on record. Be happy.
How much did you have to stop him from just doing the sides and just leaving you with the mullet?
I mean, I would have been fine with the mullet, to be honest. It was my girlfriend at the time that probably was not happy with the mullet, or would not have been happy with the mullet.
Just get the old Hawkeye haircut from Endgame, you know? It's like a... It was a mullet slash mohawk
kind of. I mean, that's a pretty cool haircut. I'd be happy with that. You know, if I was really just tempted to say to him, "Come on, just give me like a big mohawk, and that'll do. That'll do me." But I said, "No, we'll just go that way." You know, whole shaved sides, you know, high undercut thing, and yeah, it worked out. It didn't look as bad as what I thought. So there's that.
Yeah, it's one thing to trust someone to cut your hair, but when they're used to just doing a number one cut or a zero, as I do, but just do a zero cut all over. It's like, can you do this? Can you do this without just making me look bald? So the hat thing, Rain replied saying, don't subject people to the hat. So I'm going to guess she's seen the hat as well.
Oh, no, it's she's talking about the other hat that I've got. So like me and Rain are pretty good friends. And I'm going to get up and show you because it's the only way I can really do this justice.
But anyone listening to the audio feed here, I'm going to miss something.
Oh, yeah, yeah. So, exactly. This just means you have to go and watch the video now. So,
exactly. Watch and both. Listen and then watch.
Exactly. You know, do both.
I'm cheat yourself.
So, my auntie, likes to knit and, She was just looking for something to do. So I went, oh, you can make me a hat if you want. And she was like, oh, you just want like a normal woolly hat? I was like, yeah, but can you like make it really long and like multicolored? So I now have this.
Oh, wow.
And that is a statement. I don't know what the statement is, but it's a statement.
Well, so, she ticked all the requirements that you gave her. Make it long, make it colorful.
Yeah. It is made... Members of my family question my sexuality, but you know, that's fine. Let's just keep going with that.
Just wear it loud and wear it proud. So yeah, that's worth going. So yeah, if you are listening to the audio and think I see this hat, I'm not going to put a picture up of it. So you go to the video section, you find it, the YouTube, trying to figure out where does video. It's YouTube. I upload it there. Or Facebook.
Yeah, that's
you check out Facebook.
That's the only place you're going to find it as well, because I don't think I actually have a picture of it online. So,
there's the exclusive. People listening to season 4 of the podcast, go find Greg Berry's hat.
It's a really crap version of Where's Waldo.
But Oh, don't spoil the hat. No, my hat antics. I've got a chef's hat, which is signed by the Bulgarian baker from WTL. That was it's a quite snazzy hat. And
nice.
It's my favourite hat. I don't wear it outside because, you know, you can't wear a chef's hat outside without people expecting you to cook food. And
I mean, you can wear a chef's hat outside. You know, you just have to own it. You know, that's fine. If I can wear that hat outside, you can wear a chef's hat, it's fine.
That's fair. That is absolutely fair. If I had it nearby, I would have put it on in solidarity. But it's in drawers of some description. I don't know. This house is becoming a tip with clear outs. January is when we just got out of the house, and that's why this if anyone's listening to the podcast, you won't see it, but if you're watching it, the background's changed. My desk has clearly moved because there's shit everywhere in that corner that's been hidden by this camera placement. Okay, so kind of back on it. Last question from Brent in this particular section. If we share 50% of our DNA with bananas and 1 in 4 people descend from Genghis Khan, does that mean Genghis Khan was 200% banana?
No, it actually means he was 1/4 avocado.
I didn't know what to get. I didn't know what to expect from the answer, and
I didn't know what he was expecting either. But you know, let's just keep him going.
Yeah,
you know, just leave him wondering more.
Yeah, you can ask another question. I'm sure when we do part 3 of this, whatever that is, in a year's time when you've got a belt, that's what keep going.
Is that the prediction? Yeah, if I get a belt, that's the only time we'll do in our podcast when I get a belt. Okay. So it was a good last episode of this podcast for me.
When you finally when you beat Brent for the Day of Birth Bonanza Championship, we're back on, and you'll have it in obviously polythene or
like I'll DQ myself. It's fine. I'll just DQ myself. I'm not touching that belt.
Anyway, so outside of actually being able to do wrestling, you said that you found the seminars, you enjoyed them, but that's not really what you wanted to keep yourself going. Were you finding ways to kind of do home workouts, anything like that, or were you just finding watching AEW or old TNA, which I'm going to get back to because I love old TNA, but were you finding that was a bit more enjoyable as well as educational?
With the seminars, I did, like, obviously, like you said, not what I originally was there for, but I appreciated all the same. I did enjoy them, got a lot out of them. I was doing like home workouts when the gyms opened up as well. I was going back to them. What I really did enjoy was like match study. Now, after the Kings of the North seminar, I did actually reach out to both Bonesaw and Corvin. And just basically you know, because I never got a chance to ask some questions like on the live. I just asked them a bunch of questions, asked them if I can send anything to them. And like they said, yeah, no, that's fine. Perfect. Brilliant. Which I did actually have some footage to do, like, you know, just from like training and that. Got massive amount of feedback from them on like a lot of stuff that way. And then like I just asked them straight up. I was like, okay, what would you say? Like what kind of matches should I be watching if I want to accomplish, you know, X, Y, and Z? And they gave me a bunch to look back on. So like match studying was really, really kept me going in that respect, I'd say. But yeah, that's probably like the only other things that would keep me going with the wrestling, that. And also just like, you know, character work and like, you know, actually just thinking about my own gimmick and what I wanted to do and what I wanted to actually achieve when lockdown was over and when we can go back.
It's quite amazing. I've done very few seminars. I've dropped in on some, and it's amazing how after maybe an hour of a wrestler talking about a match structure, that it just changes everything you think about when you watch a wrestling match. Whereas before you'd watch a match and you think, oh, that's quite good, and then after a seminar you'd be watching again, going, oh, he did this little thing. He moved this way. He got out of the way, but did it so subtly. He did it this way, and it's quite mind blowing. It adds an extra layer to watching wrestling that I didn't think would be possible. So old school TNA. How old school are we talking about?
So I have like watched snippets of when they originally aired. So like I watched the first like I cut a lot of their full pay-per-view shows are available on YouTube for free, either from them or from other sources. So like I did go back and watch it when it was NWA TNA. But like right around the mid-2000s is probably where I'd say old school TNA. Like before they like changed it right over to Impact, like just, you know, calling itself Impact Wrestling. So like that's as old school as I'll go. Like, I still remember watching like, you know, Abyss and AJ Styles tearing it up in like Six Sides of Steel and Monsters Balls and everything like that. I still remember Matt Morgan. I think probably one of my favorite segments from old school TNA, and this is probably like the earliest of old school TNA, is when they did the whole EV 2.0 invasion or something. Like ECW, but it's like TNA, and I remember that just thinking to myself, that was great, loved that. Like, it doesn't get any better than this, surely.
Then you go back and you see BG James and Kip James calling out Michael Hickenbottom and Paul Levesque at the Alamo. And that was a high point. But no, you mentioned AJ Styles. I think it was a lockdown. Lockdown 2005, I think it was. That was
a lockdown or something.
Yeah.
I would say that TNA, obviously, if you're gonna watch TNA, like it's good now. For a little while, Impact Wrestling, like it was kind of the butt of like a lot of jokes, I'd say. Even to the point where WWE were like saying, "Oh, your TNA is hiring like live on air and stuff like that." When it's just like that's why you need to go back to the old school. The old school was good, and they knew what they were doing. And like even like just going back and watching the X Division then, like, and I have no hope of like doing what any of those guys were able to do then. But is just watching it and appreciating it, going, yeah, this is cool.
So it's great. I got into it around about 2003, and then when Hogan came in, 2010, I think that's when I kind of dipped away from it. That was when Hogan came in and took away the six sides and got aces and eights for a bit, and then that was kind of went away from that point. But no, there's some gems in there. I suppose when you're looking at guys that looking at characters as well that you could possibly pick things up from. You've got like the Bully Ray character who just wasn't Bubba Ray Dudley. He was this badass, three dimensional, pun not intended, character with all that and his Calfzilla stuff. And there was some good stuff in TNA, I think, an Impact. I think just got to sift through some really lean times to get there, but same with any other company, I suppose.
Like a lot of this is going to sound like really weird, but Bully Ray and Rockstar Spud working together was like probably one of my favorite parts of like that kind of run. I was like, yeah, okay, I like these guys. It was just funny, and I love Bully Ray as a character, and I love Rockstar Spud, and yeah.
But no, and again, it's a case of you can see guys like Nick Aldis, he appeared there as Magnus, of course. Mm-hmm. Doug Williams popped up. So it wasn't like it was just Grado and O'Darg the Great and Joe Hendry. They all appeared in TNA at some point or Impact. So again, it's another place where you're looking at and going, that's a possibility, because it's not unusual to have British wrestlers there. World X Cup way back when, with the likes of Jody Fleisch and Johnny Storm and all that kind of thing. So it's another thing, you can watch it now that you've learned or learning to become a wrestler. It's another place where you can go, you know what, it's entirely possible that I could be there and learning from Scott D'Amore and all that kind of stuff. So it's again another layer of appreciation that you can have watching back these wrestling shows and going, yeah, that's I get that. I could do that as well. Is there anyone in particular that you've watched back in your old school TNA that you think if they were brought like pulled in the multiverse, pulled through to today, that you would have loved to get in the ring with?
From old school TNA. Let me put you on the spot now. That is a tough one. I would probably... Yeah, no, it probably would have to... I'll go with a realistic one. It would probably be, like, again, just Billy Ray. And he still goes today, so it can happen. Who knows? But as like that's the only one on top of my list, because I couldn't imagine myself working AJ Styles. Just never going to happen. Saying that, though, like, obviously I know that, you know, AJ has been over here, and he's wrestled loads of guys here. And, you know, it still wouldn't happen. I just know that. This would be a good one.
Eric Young's coming over this month, I think. January. Well, I don't know if he is now because of...
No, he's cancelled. But yeah, Eric Young, definitely. I actually did not think about him. And that is definitely one, especially now, like, with, like, this new... Since post-WWE, I think, even more now, it's like, yeah, no, I definitely do want to get in there with him now. But, yeah, I didn't even think there.
He's definitely changed from his TNA days, and he's Don't Fire Eric and Super Eric and the Fish Market Street Fight. And, oh, God, there you go, watch that. That just popped into my head. Billy Ray and everything as well.
Didn't Eric Young and OVD win the tag team titles at one point?
They won the women's tag team titles, yes.
That was it. I was thinking myself, like, they definitely won a title together. What was it?
Yeah. Oh, won the women's tag team titles. But, oh, Fish Market Street Fight, that's my jam. I'm writing that down. I'm going to go watch that. So that's for anyone unaware, that's Team 3D against Sharkboy Curryman. And Super Eric turns up at some point, I think, near the end.
Sharkboy and Curryman. Oh, mate.
Billy Ray kisses a fish. That sells you on the match in itself, and he gets hooked. I think he throws a... This is TNA podcast now, but I think Curryman like ties a Twinkie to a fishing rod and then throws it outside, and then they grabs it and tries to eat it. And gets
I'm remembering this.
And he gets hooked by the fish. Oh man, well, that's my evening sorted. We're wrapped up. Not that I'm chasing you away. I'm not gonna go right. That's it. Interview's over. I'm gonna watch Fish Market.
That's fine. That's fine. I don't need to answer that last question. Let's go.
No. We'll have that. Right. Okay. So since we last spoke, of course, we've added a new question to our ridiculous question pile with the dinosaurs. It's now: would win a fight, two sheep or one cow?
We'd want to fight two sheep or one cow.
What would win in a fight?
Physically the cow, but morally the sheep.
I like that. So, you've sat on the fence, but you've kind of spun it a little bit there. Great, that's fine.
I'm really good at that.
So for anyone that's jumping in, this is now 125 podcasts I've done, this SWN podcast. That's the professional level that we're at. Fish Market Street Fight and two sheep versus one cow.
There we go.
Have you got any D&D sessions in since we last spoke in 2020?
Oh, yeah.
Any Zoom sessions in?
So we've managed to get a few games in. I've managed to actually finish the game that I was running. So it was like a... I run my games like as in seasons. Like, my first game I ever did, we called it season one of Grey Walls Peeps, and it was madness. And then some of the players are like, oh, we want season two, and I'm saying, well, these are getting a season zero, and it was like a prequel that ran, that had to get put on hold because of COVID and everything like that. And like, we just finished it last year, about a month before Christmas. And we actually got to meet up for that, which was great. And now I'm taking a little break from DMing. I'm just going to be a player for a little while until we get another spot open for being a DM, and then I'll continue running games. I'm always looking to explore more gaming systems though as well, because I primarily just do play Dungeons & Dragons 5e. So if anyone within the actual wrestling community or just whoever is listening wants to like do that or play any other kind of systems like Vampire Masquerade or I believe there's a Witcher one now as well. Hit me up, and I will gladly try that. I do actually want to, there was something I did want to try and get like a D&D podcast for SWN. I mentioned that to you like before.
Yeah.
I did want to try that at one point. It's just been a case of time and effort and not actually having the equipment to do it with. And then obviously if no one knows who to play D&D, it's teaching them. I think that'd be fun getting a bunch of wrestlers on to play D&D on here.
I mean, there was Kurt Johansson. He was supposed to be starting one that never happened. It was I'm sure it's been recorded and it just hasn't been put out or I've missed it. But it was him, Ian Skinner, and Emily Hayden all playing D&D. So there's definitely seems to be a market out there. What I've learned on these 2 years of doing podcasts is a lot of wrestlers like D&D, a lot of wrestlers like anime, and that seems to just be quite a common. I don't know why it's a D&D. I can almost understand because it's like character work. So that must be, there's an overlap there, I suppose. Even subconsciously, there's an overlap. But yeah, it's just weird that a lot of wrestlers, anime, D&D. That seems to be the common bond.
The thing with anime is, and this is what people will either agree with me with this or they'll hate me for it. But I think the reason a lot of wrestlers like anime is because wrestling is Brent's gonna hate me for this. Wrestling is basically anime for rednecks, in my opinion. This if it makes sense, just let it sink in. Like, you know, all the big, like the overhyped characters, like the bigger than life characters, the moves, some wrestlers that call out their moves before doing them, just like the anime characters do, the settings, the storylines. It's quite similar in a lot of respects.
I let that one breathe, just in case there's anyone that disagrees with
this is where I get cancelled. This is like where I don't get booked again.
This is a controversy. This is a controversial episode. All right, I think Brent will forgive you because we're going to ask the question now. Right, so the first question he sent in as soon as I announced that you were going to be on the show was, ask you what happened at Comic-Con. And I will also add, Johnny Reeves also added, it's a particularly interesting story, but you can't remember the end of it. So I'd like a wee refresher.
Yeah, he's a dick. Okay, so... Right, so just put this in the context. This was again at summer camp where like we're doing an exercise where like in order to like, you know, do a promo you have to like tell a story. And like I got just so you know, the story I'm about to tell about Comic-Con is completely made up. I had to make it up on the spot because I couldn't actually think of a time where this had happened. So I got asked, have you ever shit yourself? And I was just like, I mean, probably. I mean, I don't know when, like, because I don't tend to keep a record of this shit, literally. So like, all right, so tell me about a time where you shit yourself. And I couldn't think of anything. I was like, all right. And the first thing that came kind of popped in my head was Comic-Con, so maybe I shot myself at Comic-Con, who knows. So I had to tell the story of make up the story of like a time where I was at, you know, Comic-Con and I had, you know, a case of like drinking too heavily and, you know, eating a lot of curry the night before and it all catching up to me the next day. And it was just for all the purposes of like telling the story to like get across that, yeah, you can do a promo because you've told a story there. And it just ends with me saying that, yeah, so I shot myself at Comic-Con. And to which I still get ribbed today for it at FBWA. Everyone's still like, and now the whole world knows. Well, sorry, everyone that listens to SWN knows this.
The world. We're going to go for the whole world, yeah.
Yeah, the whole world, yeah. The whole world knows I shat myself at Comic-Con. Sorry, shat myself at Comic-Con.
Just watch the edit when I put this out, just so I take it out.
Oh, you dear. Oh, yeah, you can take this old question out if you want. We can just send it. We can just send it and say, look, we did it, but it's not going out. It's funny because...
I'll just take out the made up bit, you know, I made that story up.
Cheers.
That's a bit out. Just, it's real.
No, it's funny because Rain was saying, oh, you know, that's canon now. Like, you know, yeah, it's fine. You made like, you made the story up, but it's canon now. Everyone's going to believe it. I'm like, okay, cool. That's fine. If that's what gets me over in wrestling, I'll take it. Why not?
I mean, you're not going to go all out to like make it your character.
Oh, definitely not. You know, no. Oh, hang on, guys. I need to, like, halfway through a tag match. I'll be back in a minute. Not kind of thing. Oh, geez. Here we go.
The brown snake.
I said no. That should be Cobra. That'll do. Never mind.
The Crimson Cobra. That's a way cooler name. We're not going to...
Yeah.
We're not going to end the podcast with me making terrible nicknames for your wrestling character. So I'm trying to avoid that again because I cringed last time I did it. And I'm not doing it again. We can do this. I'm a professional. Professional
yeah. Just talking about me shit myself at Comic-Con. It's fine. That's professional. It's cool. It's cool, man. It's cool. I would like to state, though, in all seriousness, that I did, in fact, make that story up. And, you know, no one's going to believe me, but it's fine.
Okay, right. Let's get this show back on some sort of professional level. But that was well worth asking. Thank you very much, Brent. You might not be alive to hear this particular podcast, but thank you for sending those questions in. So as we look ahead, we're in 2022. We're recording right about the start of 2022. This will come out at the end of the month. You've mentioned all the way through, like, kind of your goals and inspirations, aspirations, I should say. It's just getting out and getting to our company and wrestling. What would be, like, if you could do one thing this year, if you could wrestle one person this year, if it could be one company that you have to get to in 2022, is there anyone in your short-term goal list?
Short-term-wise... I would love to wrestle for either Discovery or WrestleZone. I do want to debut again for our promotion this year. But if I had to pick, like, you know, one, that would be one of those two. Definitely just because I love what Disco do. The one time that I was able to actually go to a WrestleZone show, I just love the atmosphere. I love that, you know, in fact, they've actually got a loyal fan base and everything like that. I'd like to make an impact at either one of those places. In terms of, like, wrestling, like, one person I'd like to wrestle. When we were doing the seminars, that me and Skinner used to speak quite a lot, like, go back and forth and that. And I would just love to get, like, just in the ring with him at one point, because I've seen what he can do, and I'm very much, like, eager to show him what I can do as well, which... albeit, you know, probably isn't as good as what he does, but, like, I think something would be good there. You know, and, like, he's already been able to wrestle both Robbie and Ross Hunter from FPWA recently, so, like, he's knows what FPWA can do, and I just want to go and show more what we're all about. But yeah, like, that would probably be, like, the short-term goals that way. And there's a bunch of other people on my list that I do want to wrestle, which I could just list off to you right now. But we'll save that for another time, maybe. Maybe that'll just be a case of look at this list. Everyone's checked off on it. You know, I've done it all. That kind of shit, hopefully. But yeah, there's this everything, you know.
Yeah, Ian Skinner, he seems to be high on everyone's list this year. So it's definitely... absolutely possible that you can get in the ring with him. And again, because he's got that kind of, I won't say nerdy side, but saying that from a nerd really kind of does not hold any weight. But he's got that kind of side of him, like D&D and anime stuff. You kind of got a similar personality, but his is a bit more out there, just a bit more reserved. Especially, well, as your character, I should say. I don't know, outside of the Zoom call, you could be... absolutely wild and crazy. I don't know. But yeah.
So I mean, if you see me in the radio days, then yeah, definitely, I was wild and crazy, and that's what that is.
I did bring up radio last time, and I was going to try and wrap up with the Comic-Con question, but I've got so many more things that I think of now. But radio questions, anyway. So we brought this up last time, you did radio. I spoke to Billy Kirkwood since, and of course he does morning radio. I'm just curious, is there a song when you're doing radio that comes up on the playlist? Of course, you don't often get to be in charge of the playlist. Is there any song that comes up that you just think, no, why am I getting played? Why do I have to play this again?
In the most professional sense, no, there's never a song like that. I love every song and that comes on that radio. I know every word to every song that comes on the radio because I have to love every song that comes on the radio. Because if I say I don't like a song,
least favorite, then we'll go with that. So it's still, you still like it, but it wouldn't be a choice you put on straight away.
I'm trying to think, what's that new song that's out right now? Oh, I can't remember the name. I can't remember the name of it, or even the artist says it just proves how much I'm. Maybe it's not my favorite song. It's the one that goes, "Well, good for you. I hope you're happy in hell."
Oh,
another one I'm on about. Yeah,
Olivia Rodrigo.
It's on TikTok a lot. I know that much. I'm just like, uh huh. Like, and I think it's because it's on TikTok a lot. I'm just like, I'm kind of done with it. It's still a good song. It's just, it's
that alphabet one. I think I might be Olivia Rodrigo as well. That A, B, C, D.
A, B, C, yeah.
That one, I don't like. Man. Because on TikTok, it's the unedited version, but on the radio, it's the radio edit. And I'm listening going, this sounds weird. I've heard the real song, man.
Let's get the real song in there. It's cool, but unfortunately, Ofcom rules and everything like that, But yeah,
it works either way, because when I heard CeeLo Green, Forget You, and I heard the unedited version, I was like, no, that sounds weird. I'm so used to hearing Forget You. And then...
I get that.
But I just like to find it, because I listened to MFR during the day, just in the background, like White Noise, and I used to do Little Mix. I love me a little bit of Little Mix, but when I hear it 4 times an hour, I don't like Little Mix as much.
I know. You just don't. It's understandable, but at the same time, I could listen to that song, but again, because it's getting played a lot, I'm just like, okay, no, I don't want to hear it anymore. Like, I know the words to it, and I don't even listen to it. That's the thing. It's not on my playlist. I've never played it on Spotify. I've never done this. It's just because TikTok. Because yes, I do the TikTok, as some people say, and I hate myself for it, but still.
I stopped posting, but yeah, I do find myself losing far too much time on TikTok for nothing. I couldn't even tell you. If you asked me what I watched on TikTok, I couldn't tell you. I have no idea. It's just consuming all this information. Right, let's wrap this up then, because like I say, we're not talking the Comic-Con story that did or did not happen. We'll take your word for it. We'll trust you.
You can trust a snake, right? You can trust a snake. It's fine.
Absolutely. So where can people find you on social media then? Where can people find more about Craig Berry and not ask you about Comic-Con?
So you can find me on Facebook at Craig Berry Wrestler. You can get me on Twitter and Instagram at Craig Berry 101. And if you're so inclined to, have a look at TikTok as well, because I am on TikTok, you can find me under the name Branded Sloth. It's on there somewhere, I'm sure. You type in Craig Berry, you'll probably get like an old account that was there when it was called something else. But other than that, yeah, that's all my social medias, I'm sure. That's it.
Thank you very much for joining me today. Oh, actually, we do one more question.
We're
trying to make a season 4 finale question, which is, if dream match, you're wrestling WrestleMania, biggest show of the year, you get the choice of opponent or opponents. Who are they and why?
Spot, man. Put me on the spot. So, main event WrestleMania, any opponents I want. Oh, actually, no, I do have it. I would have a singles match against either Mick Foley, preferably Cactus Jack, or even Mankind at that point. And this, there can be any stipulation. I don't care. Yeah. I just want a match with Mick Foley. because I find myself more and more trying to like not emulate him as much, but like I appreciated his style in that. Fair enough, like I'm not gonna like jump off the you know, top rope on the concrete. I'm not gonna do that. But like at the same time, it's like his character work and, you know, what he did was amazing. And Cactus Jack even more so. So like Cactus Jack was like my personal favorite. So I'd probably say that, yeah, main event at WrestleMania, Mick Foley, preferably Cactus Jack, and like his Cactus Jack, alter ego, and any stipulation match.
Well, thank you very much for joining me today. Everyone go and follow Craig Berry everywhere, except to his home. And then, yeah, we'll hopefully catch up with you in a future season. We'll like I say, you either have a belt or we'll just have our catch up. I might learn about D&D. I might join you on the learning about D&D side of things.
That's fine.
Stuff, because everyone else seems to be doing it. I'd be as well just try and jump in now and learn something.
And once you get the expensive books, you're fine.
Okay. No, but yeah, we'll do that. But no, yeah, thank you very much.
Always, man. Thank you very much.